Hello, friends, and welcome to my virtual Sunday school class. You are in for a treat today. Amen? Okay, so let's look at the title for our class. And the title for our class is, ta-da, Pentecostal Experience Continues. Amen? And let's look at the lesson overview. And here's our lesson overview. First, what is the central truth of our lesson? God's will is that every believer in Christ be baptized in the Holy Spirit. Amen. Okay. What's the focus of our lesson? Acknowledge that God still gives the Holy Spirit and invite the Spirit into our lives. Point number three, what is the evangelism emphasis? God desires all people to believe in Christ and receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah! Friends, do you realize that Christianity is the only religion that says where the very Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, comes and dwells inside of us. And He's the Spirit of truth. He's our comforter. He's our guide. He's our advocate. He's our everything while we are sojourning in this world today. And that's why this lesson is so awesome and is so important. Hallelujah. All right. Next, let's look at the golden text. The golden text is coming from the book of Acts, chapter 11, verse 16. Then remembered I the word of the Lord, how that he said, John indeed baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah! Thank you, Jesus. Okay, next what we're going to do is we're going to sing a worship song, and y'all can worship along with me, but the song has been pre-recorded, okay?
It's beginning to rain. Hear the voice of my Father saying, whosoever will come drink of the water, I promise to pour my Spirit out on your sons and your daughters. If you're thirsty and dry, look up to the sky. It's beginning to rain. The turtle dove is singing the sweet songs of morning. The leaves on the trees turn the silver cups to the sky. The silent clouds above are beginning to gather, and the barren land is so thirsty, and so am I. It's beginning to rain. Hear the voice of my Father saying, whosoever will come drink of the water, I promise to pour my Spirit out on your sons and your daughters. If you're thirsty and dry, look up to the sky. It's beginning to rain. at the first drop of rain that you hear, throw open your windows. Go call all your children together, throw wide the door. When the rains of the Spirit are falling, fill every vessel. For he who drinks his fill shall thirst no more.
It's beginning to rain. Hear the voice of my Father saying, whosoever will come drink of the water, I promise to pour my Spirit out on your sons and your daughters. If you're thirsty and dry, look up to the sky. It's beginning to rain. Hallelujah. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you and we praise you, for you are an awesome God. And Father, it's beginning to rain, Lord. You have promised us in your word that in the last days you will pour out of your Spirit upon all flesh. Our sons and our daughters shall prophesy. Our young men shall see visions, and our old men shall dream dreams. And upon your servants and your handmaidens, you will pour out of your Spirit, Lord. Do it again, Lord, like you did it on the day of Pentecost, Lord. We need a fresh outpouring of your Holy Spirit today, Lord. We're living in a world that's so completely messed up that we're desperate for you, Father. We're hungry for you, Lord. We need a fresh, mighty infilling of your Holy Spirit like you poured it out on the day of Pentecost, Lord. Do it again, God. We beg of you. We entreat you, Lord. Do it, Father. And Father, we thank you that the very hairs on our head have been numbered by you. Thank you that the thoughts that you think are more numerous than the grains of sand in the sea. Thank you that you've engraved us in the palms of your hand. Thank you that we are the apple of your eye. Thank you that you loved us so much that you gave your only begotten Son, Jesus, to die on the cross for us, for the forgiveness of our sins, and to be raised from the dead on the third day, Lord. And we want to thank you for the soon coming return of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, Father. And Father, now I come to you for my Sunday school class, Lord. I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable unto you. Guard my mouth and my tongue to say only those things that are edifying and glorifying to you, Lord. And Father, help me to speak the truth with boldness, but to speak it in love, for we ask it in Jesus' matchless name. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. And thank you for tuning in. All right. Next thing we're going to do is we're going to go to the scripture summary for our class. All right. Point number one, converts receive the Spirit. Aha. Acts chapter 8, 4 through 8, verse 12, and then verses 14 through 17 from that same chapter 8. Point number two, the Gentiles receive the Spirit. Acts chapter 10, 44 through 48, and 11, chapter 11, 15 through 18. And then point number three, the disciples receive the Spirit. John's disciples receive the Spirit. Acts chapter 9, 1 through 7. And all these are coming from the NKJV version, the New King James Version. Okay? All right. And with that, we are going to the introduction for our class, all right? So here's the introduction. This coming Sunday is Pentecost Sunday on the Christian calendar. And we often focus on Acts chapter 2, which relates the initial outpouring of the Holy Spirit on the disciples of Jesus. The Holy Spirit came upon the first Christians at the time of the Jewish festival of Pentecost, which is also called the Feast of Weeks. Jesus had instructed his disciples to remain in Jerusalem until they received the promised Holy Spirit, which would give them power from on high. Hallelujah. Luke chapter 24 and verse 49. You shall receive power after the Holy Ghost comes upon you. You shall be my witnesses in Judea and Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the world. Amen. Therefore, they prayed and worshiped expectantly until the day of Pentecost. The festival is called Pentecost because it means 50th, and it comes 50 days after Passover. When the day of Pentecost was fully come, the Spirit descended upon them, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, with the Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Acts chapter 2, verse 1 and 4. Their baptism in the Spirit enabled them to fulfill the mission Jesus had given them. Jesus had promised, "Ye shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. You shall be my witnesses to me in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the earth." The New King James says, "And to the end of the earth." Amen. Isn't that awesome? That 12 ordinary disciples, the majority of them are fishermen and just ordinary people, turned the world upside down and spread the gospel to the uttermost parts of the earth. Amen. And this was in a day where there were no jets to fly in. There were no high-powered ships to sail the seas in. There were no railroads and railways, all that kind of stuff. There was no television, no instant communication, no Facebook. And yet, these 12 disciples of Jesus turned this world upside down for Jesus. And that could never have been accomplished unless they had been empowered by the Holy Spirit. And that's why it's so important for us to be empowered by the Holy Spirit. The remainder of the book of Acts, chapter 2 through 28, relates the spread of the gospel throughout the Roman Empire. The 120 believers who had been in the upper room went everywhere, witnessing to the saving power of Jesus Christ, the resurrected Lord. This week's lesson examines three outpourings of the Spirit that occurred after Pentecost: Acts chapter 8, chapter 10, and chapter 19. These events demonstrate the initial giving of the Spirit on the day of Pentecost was not a once and for all manifestation. On the contrary, God continued to manifest the Spirit in the early church and throughout history. Even now in the 21st century, the world is experiencing a great outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Do it again, Lord. Do it again. And so let's go to point number one, where it says, converts receive the Spirit, okay? So converts receive the Spirit. Here we go. And salvation comes to Samaria. Therefore, those who were scattered went everywhere preaching the word. Then Philip went down. By the way, these were the 120 that were in the upper room that received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Then Philip went down to the city of Samaria and preached Christ to them. And the multitudes with one accord heeded the things spoken by Philip, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. Notice that the Samaritans saw and heard everything that he spoke, Philip spoke, and the miracles which he did. Amen? Let's go on. For unclean spirits, crying with a loud voice, came out of many who were possessed, and many who were paralyzed and lame were healed. Aha, so there were all kinds of miracles happening. People were set free from demonic spirits, unclean spirits who were possessed, and many who were paralyzed and lame were healed. Hallelujah. And there was great joy in that city. Okay? And then let's look at verse 12. But when they believed Philip as he preached the things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, both men and women were baptized. Hallelujah. This is talking about the Samaritans, okay? And how salvation comes to Samaria. Hallelujah. Well, let's go back and dig into the text and see what nuggets of truth we can find, okay? All right. In the first 5 years following Pentecost, the early church enjoyed rapid growth. The success of the Jesus movement angered the Jewish leaders in Jerusalem, and they began to persecute the Christians. The stoning of Stephen was an example of the rising opposition to the message of the gospel. Acts chapter 6, verse 8 to Acts chapter 7, verse 60. And we can't turn there because we don't have enough time, but y'all can look that up. Hoping to escape persecution, the believers were scattered and they went everywhere preaching the word. Hallelujah. Chapter 8, verses 1 through 4. One of the early converts in Jerusalem was named Philip. Who became a leader in the early church. Philip and six others had been chosen as the first deacons because they were full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom. Aha! Chapter 6, verse 3. Okay. After Stephen's death, Philip traveled to the city of Samaria and began to preach there. Chapter 8, verse 5. The people were very receptive. Why? Because of the miracles that accompanied Philip's preaching. The miracles included many healings of serious illnesses, casting out of unclean spirits, demons, devils. Healings included those taken with palsies, those that were lame, meaning they were paralyzed. In our time, we would call these sufferers paraplegics, and they would be confined to wheelchairs. Therefore, a modern equivalent would be to say many were healed and came out of their wheelchairs even. The miracles, the deliverances, and the conversions to Christ created a mood of great joy in Samaria. Verse 8. We can imagine the joy that would result from a revival where many of our friends and relatives were delivered from bondages and healed of major illnesses. Hallelujah. Wow. The phrase when they believed signifies a point in time when people exercise saving faith. The verbs believe and the noun faith come from the same root word in the original Greek, pistis, P-I-S-T-I-S. A great number of converts, both men and women, verse 12, were baptized. The baptism of new converts continued the ordinance instituted by Jesus, Matthew 28 and 19, and practiced by the apostles, Acts 2 and 41. Okay? All right. Supernatural impartation. In the classic TV show, The $6 Million Man, astronaut Steve Austin received robotic implants to replace both of his legs, an arm, and an eye that had been severely damaged in a test flight accident. These bionic body parts made Steve a superhuman. The $6 Million Man was fiction, but there is a way for humans to receive genuine supernatural abilities. The Holy Spirit bestows the power of God upon otherwise weak human vessels, giving believers gifts of knowledge, wisdom, healing, prophecy, miracles, and more. Hallelujah! Thank you, Lord. Thank you for the gifts of the Holy Spirit that you've given us. All right, now point number B, Pentecost comes to Samaria. Okay, so let's go to Pentecost comes to Samaria. Now when the apostles who were in Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent Peter and John to them, who when they had come down, prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit. For as yet he had fallen upon none of them. They had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then they laid hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah! Okay, all right, let's dig for nuggets of gold here, okay? And let's see what all this is talking about. The apostles in Jerusalem heard about Philip's successful evangelism, and they sent Peter and John to oversee the new work there. When Peter and John arrived, they learned the Samaritans had not yet been baptized in the Holy Spirit, even though they had received the word of God and had been baptized in water. Chapter 8, verse 14 and 16. Therefore, the Samaritan revival demonstrates it is possible to be born of the Spirit, John 3, 5 through 6, but not be filled with the Spirit, Ephesians 5, 18, Acts 2 and 4. Everyone who is born again is indwelt by the Holy Spirit, Romans 8 and 9. But not every believer has been baptized or filled with the Holy Spirit. It is important that we clarify our terminology regarding the work of the Holy Spirit. The terms baptized with the Spirit and filled with and filled with the Spirit refer to the same dynamic work. We know they are the same because Jesus told his disciples they would be baptized with the Holy Spirit in a few days, Acts 1 and 5. But when the event happened, it is said they were filled with the Spirit, chapter 2 and 4. The distinction in terms is that baptism refers to the initial experience of being filled, and the initial experience can happen only once. The first time experience of Spirit baptism may also be called receiving the Spirit, as it is here in 8:15. However, a believer can be filled with the Spirit over and over, even daily. Hallelujah! The disciples were filled at Pentecost. The disciples who were filled at Pentecost were filled again just a few days later, 4:31. A person who is continually filled with the Spirit is said to be full of the Spirit, chapter 6 and verse 3. Because the coming of the Spirit in power is such an extraordinary experience, it can also be described as the Spirit falling upon believers, chapter 8, verse 16, chapter 10, verse 44, chapter 11, verse 15, and see also Ezekiel chapter 11 and verse 5. And unfortunately, we don't have time to turn there. Philip's converts were indwelled by the Spirit because they had received Jesus, but they had not received Spirit baptism as an endowment of power. However, when the apostles Peter and John laid their hands on the new Christians, the Holy Spirit came upon them. The laying on of hands was an ancient custom that symbolized the transferring of authority from one person to another. By the laying on of hands, Moses bestowed the Spirit on Joshua, Numbers 27 and 23, and Deuteronomy 3, 4 through 9. The Israelites laid hands on the Levites to authorize them for ministry, Numbers 8 and 10. When Ananias laid his hands on Saul, Saul was healed and filled with the Holy Spirit, Acts 9 and 17. Timothy received gifts of ministry when Paul, 1 Timothy 4 and 14, and the elders laid hands on him, 2 Timothy 1 and 16. The coming of the Spirit of the day of Pentecost was evidenced by speaking in tongues, and apparently the same sign took place in Samaria. Acts 8 and 18 says a man named Simon saw the Spirit had been given. Therefore, the reception of the Spirit was accompanied by some visible or audible signs. Throughout the books of Luke and Acts, the filling of the Spirit normally resulted in some kind of inspired speech. Therefore, we can assume the same was true of the Samaritans' experience, okay? Luke 1 and 4, 1 and 41 through 42, 6, 67, verse 67, Acts 2 and 4, verses 4 through 8, 31, and then 13, 9 through 10. We might ask why Peter and John thought it necessary to go to Samaria to pray for the Christians to be filled with the Holy Spirit. They believed on the Lord and they were baptized. Was that not good enough? Did the Samaritans really need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit? Is the Spirit-filled life meant for every Christian? Or is it only for ministers, missionaries, and other leaders? The Apostle Peter answered that question earlier in his Pentecost sermon with a resounding yes. The Spirit-filled life is for every believer. He declared, for the promise is unto you and to your children and to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. Hallelujah. Earlier the same day in Jerusalem, when the Holy Spirit invaded the upper room, all, not just a few of them, were filled with the Spirit. On a later occasion, the early church was gathered for prayer, and once again, all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit. Still later, Peter preached at the house of Cornelius, and the Spirit came upon all who heard Peter's preaching. According to the book of Acts, Spirit baptism is for you, me, everyone who receives Jesus Christ as Savior. Hallelujah! Thank you, Lord. Okay, now let's go on to the next point because we are kind of running out of time. And the point is, point number two, Gentiles received the Spirit. The Gentile Pentecost. While Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit fell upon all those who heard the word. And this is in Acts chapter 10, verses 44 through 48. And this is describing, this is now not the Samaritans, but this is talking about the Gentiles and how they received the Spirit. While Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit fell upon all those who heard the word. And those of the circumcision who believed were astonished as many as came with Peter, because the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out on the Gentiles also. Wow. For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. Then Peter answered, "Can anyone forbid water that these should be baptized who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have?" Hallelujah. And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord. Then they asked him to stay a few days. Aha! All right. So let's go and see what this is all talking about, okay? The Holy Spirit was first given to the 120 disciples in Jerusalem on the day of Pentecost, and then to all of the converts who came to Jesus through the preaching of the apostles, Acts 2:38. These new converts in Jerusalem were Jews, but as the preaching of the gospel expanded from Jerusalem into Samaria and beyond, the Spirit was poured out on non-Jews as well. The first outpouring of the Holy Spirit on the Gentiles happened in Caesarea about 7 years after Pentecost at the home of Cornelius, a Roman centurion. Cornelius was not a Christian, but he feared God, cared for the poor, and prayed to God always. Chapter 10, verse 2. As he prayed one morning, an angel came to him in a vision in which God instructed him to bring the apostle Peter to his home, and Peter would tell him what he must do. Although Peter was hesitant to go into the house of a Gentile, he had received a vision in which God instructed him to go to Cornelius' house and preach the gospel. While Peter preached, the Holy Spirit came down on all those who heard the message. Without warning and without planning, Holy Spirit descended upon the people in a sudden, forceful, and miraculous way. We cannot schedule the moving of the Holy Spirit, but we can pray for it and expect it. As everyone in Cornelius' household was filled with the Spirit, they all spake in tongues. They all spoke in tongues, verse 46, replicating what had happened at Pentecost. Amen. And this happened so all the Jews who had received the Holy Ghost would believe that now the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on the Gentiles. Those of the circumcision were the Jewish believers who had come with Peter, and they were astonished. The Spirit had been given to the Gentiles. Chapter 10, verse 44. Remember, the Jews considered the Gentiles as almost outcasts, okay? At that time, the Jewish Christians believed Christ was king of the Jews only. Therefore, if a Gentile wished to become a Christian, they must also become a Jew and practice Judaism. Peter, remembering his dream in which God had told him not to reject anyone as unclean, verses 15 and 23, offered water baptism to these Gentiles. He reasoned God's filling them with the Spirit was sufficient proof that they had been accepted by God. So they should be baptized and accepted by the church. Unlike the converts of Samaria, new believers in Cornelius' house did not receive the Spirit by the laying on of hands. Also, the order of spiritual experience at Cornelius' house was different from the order at Samaria. The Samaritans accepted Jesus. They were baptized in water. Then they received the Spirit. In contrast, Cornelius' group received the gospel message. They received the Spirit, and then they were baptized. Hallelujah. I think an important lesson is you can't put the Holy Spirit in a box and say if he work, he has to work in this sort of a fashion. That's not possible, as we have seen over here, okay? So let's go on, okay? And let's go to the Gentile Pentecost recounted Acts 11, 15 through 18, and we're kind of running out of time, okay? The Gentile Pentecost. Acts 10, 44 through 48. And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord. Then they asked him to stay a few days. All right? Acts 10, 44 through 48. Oh, okay. We missed this, okay? Let's first go to Acts 10, 44 through the previous verses. Let's look at them. While Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit fell upon all those who heard the word, and those of the circumcision who believed were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out on the Gentiles also, okay? For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. Then Peter answered, can anyone forbid water that these should not be baptized who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have? And the answer was, of course not. And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of the Lord. Then they asked him to stay a few days. Amen. All right, let's go on to the next thing. The Gentile Pentecost recounted, Acts 11, 15 through 18. Verse 15, as I began to speak, the Holy Spirit fell upon them, as upon us at the beginning. Then I remembered the word of the Lord, how he said, John indeed baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. If therefore God gave them the same gift as he gave us when we believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could withstand God? When they heard these things, they became silent. They glorified God, saying, then God has also granted to the Gentiles repentance to life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Notice what it says, that God had granted repentance to life, to the Gentiles. One side note to all this is repentance comes from God. Amen? And God has to give you that repentance as he gave it to the Gentiles. Otherwise, they could not have been saved, okay? So repentance is not a work of man, but it's actually a work of God. So it's quite appropriate to say, repent and believe. There's nothing wrong with that, okay? That's just a side note. And we're kind of running out of time, so let's look at these scriptures in more detail and see what that is talking about. Peter's fellowship with Gentiles did not go unnoticed by his Jewish friends in Jerusalem, okay? And they did not approve. Peter, however, defended his action by explaining he had followed the directive of the Holy Spirit. Acts chapter 11 and verse 12. Peter recounted how the Spirit had fallen on everyone in Cornelius' house. The entire group of people had received Jesus as Savior and were filled with the Spirit. Peter pointed out further that the experience of at Cornelius' house was the same as Jesus' disciples' experience on the day of Pentecost. Peter said, God gave to them the same gift as he also gave to us also. The Jewish Christians believed Peter's testimony and they glorified God, realizing God was reaching out to the Gentiles. Despite Peter's testimony, the Jewish Christians did not change their approach to evangelism. They continued their practice of preaching only to the Jews. The mission to the Gentiles, however, was picked up by Paul and Barnabas. Chapter 13, verse 42 and verse 46. About 10 years later, and was officially approved by the church when the apostles and elders met in Jerusalem to decide the question. Chapter 15, 6 through 29. The decision of the Jerusalem Council rested partly on Peter's experience at Cornelius' house, which he recounted in front of all the apostles and elders. Hallelujah. All right. Okay, let's go on to the next point. The disciples received the Spirit, baptism of repentance, Acts 19, 1 through 4. Okay? And it happened while Apollos was at Corinth that Paul, having passed through the upper regions, came to Ephesus. And finding some disciples, he said, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed?" So they said to him, "We have not so much as heard whether there be a Holy Spirit." Okay? And he said to them, "Into what then were ye baptized?" So they said, "Into John's baptism." Then Paul said, "John indeed baptized with a baptism of repentance, saying to the people that they should believe on him who would come after him, that is on Christ Jesus." When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul laid hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they spoke with tongues and prophesied. Now the men were about 12 in all. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right. After the Jerusalem Council of chapter 15, the book of Acts is devoted almost entirely to the ministry of the Apostle Paul. About 6 years after the council, which would be about 24 years after Pentecost, Paul traveled to Ephesus, a major city in Asia Minor on the western coast is what is today Turkey. There he encountered a group of disciples who had been baptized by the followers of John the Baptist. These disciples had experienced a baptism of repentance. So Paul asked them if they had received the Holy Spirit. Since they believed, he would not have asked this question if he did not consider them to be born again. They knew nothing about the Holy Spirit. Therefore, Paul explained the full gospel to them. Amen. And then let's go to the next point, baptism in the Spirit, Acts chapter 19, 5 through 7. Okay? Acts chapter 19, 5 through 7. When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul laid hands on them, Holy Spirit came upon them, they prophesied with tongues. They spoke with tongues and prophesied. Now the men were about 12 in all. Okay? And that pretty much finishes us, finishes our lesson today. And we're going to end with our worship song. Okay? And here is our worship song.
It's beginning to rain. Hear the voice of the Father saying, "Whosoever will come drink of the water, I promise to pour my Spirit out on your sons and your daughters. If you're thirsty and dry, look up to the sky, it's beginning to rain, to rain." Hear the voice of the Father saying, "Whosoever would come drink of the water, I promise to pour my Spirit out on your sons and your daughters. If you're thirsty and dry, look up to the sky. It's beginning to rain. If you're thirsty and dry, look up to the sky. It's beginning to rain.
And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you his peace. Shalom. Nothing missing and nothing broken. And if you have not accepted Jesus as your Lord, I invite you right now. The Bible simply says, anyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Hallelujah. And you can be saved right now, and you can be baptized in the Holy Ghost based on the scriptures that I have just preached, okay? May God bless you and keep you is my prayer. And thank you for listening. And if you like the broadcast, please put likes. And please share it with others so more people will get to hear it, okay? And if you're in this area, we welcome you to come to Hope City Church. Amen. It's on 7 North Tuxedo Avenue off of Brainerd, okay? And we have an awesome pastor. Our services are on Sundays at 10:30. Pastor Sibby Thomas is our pastor. Come and listen to him. All right. Thank you for listening. Amen.